All right. So people who have been to a few of these now will be familiar with this. Our plan is for quite an interactive meeting. We've got somewhat more than 50 people, which potentially could get a little bit noisy, but you know, that's okay. We'll start off reasonably informally, and if we need to, we'll go to a slightly more formal Q&A part. But really the key point here is this is not meant to be just a presentation. This is a interactive meeting. It's a forum, an opportunity to share things. Please participate. Unmute yourself and speak when you have something to say. If it starts getting noisy, we'll ask people to raise a hand first. Yeah, but otherwise, let's start like that. If you haven't already seen, we have a NERSC user Slack, and there is a hashtag webinars channel there. That's another good place to ask questions and continue the conversation. One of the nice things about that is that the chatter there is retained beyond the end of the Zoom meeting. The slides, in fact, are already up on the webpage associated with this meeting, which is under www.nurse.gov under events. You can use those slides to find the link. And in fact, if you haven't already got this Slack link, you can post it in the chat here. Maybe I can post it in the chat here. Here we go. So if you're not on Slack, this is how you can get onto it. So our agenda follows our normal agenda for these meetings. We'll start out with a win of the month, which is an opportunity to tell about success stories. Today I learned, which is an opportunity to talk about things that didn't go as smoothly, but that maybe each other can learn something from. We'll have a section for announcements and calls for participation. And then we'll go into our topic of the day, which is around Slurm, and Shahzeb Siddiqui from NERSC's User Engagement Group will give us some tips on how to work with Slurm to get the most outcome for the least wall clock, the least queue waiting time, and the least cost. So let's start out with a win of the month. So the purpose of this segment is to show off an achievement or shout out somebody else's achievement. And it doesn't have to be big. It can be a fairly big thing, like having a paper accepted, or a relatively small thing, like solving a bug that had kept you stumped for a few days. This is also a good opportunity to tell about some scientific achievements. We know that NERSC users are doing some pretty amazing things. We don't always know the details of what those things are, but we do really like hearing about it, and we think it's inspiring for us and each other as well. In particular, NERSC hands out some awards every year for high impact scientific achievement and for innovative use of high performance computing. And maybe you're doing some work that is a candidate for those awards, and we'd love to hear about it here. On that note, actually, the early career nominations for those awards are due this week. We'll have an announcement about that fairly shortly. But just so we're especially keen to hear about that, we've got one more day before the deadline for those. So any high impact scientific work or innovative uses of high performance computing that you either are doing or know of, please nominate by the end of this week. Would anybody like to kick off with a win of the week, something they've achieved? Something I forgot to mention earlier is we are recording this session, and the video will be available on the website afterwards. So maybe people are a little shy. I'll kick one off. I had something that I was pretty pleased with how it came out, working with one of our users who is who has a high throughput computing type workflow, which and this particular workflow has an extra challenge in the individual tasks, MPI tasks, and multiple MPI tasks across, you know, per node MPI tasks across many nodes are a little bit tricky because most of the workflow tools use the MPI infrastructure to manage the workflow. And so running an MPI task inside of, or an MPI job essentially inside of a larger workflow has a few challenges. And there is kind of a known, you know, at least in principle solution, which is to use shifter containers. So create a Docker container on the laptop and set up the MPI workflow to happen sort of, you know, locally to a node within that container, and then use shifter to run that container, you know, in parallel, you know, multiple times across many nodes of Cori. And you know, it took a few you know, hiccups and starts to, you know, work out exactly how to do this without things interfering with each other and make it all work smoothly. But you know, after a couple of days of sort of backwards and forwards, we were able to make a working workflow of it, and that will make its way onto a variation of that will make its way as an example on our documentation pages in the not too distant future. But you know, I was pretty chuffed about that. Yeah, anybody got any other stories they'd like to tell?
We have not kind of wind of the month, but more like island stuff that might be you know, interesting to share. So I was running, I'll try to run globally high resolution simulations in the context of climate simulations. But again, IO has been taking quite a lot of chunks of time, but I just realized, so again, considering the file size ranging from the tens of gigabyte to 100 gigabyte as a model output, I didn't realize that I have not set properly the raster file striping before. For example, in the end of the simulations, the model write the restart file that's, you know, more than 100 gigabytes, but it taking, you know, worst time about 2 hours to just write this file. But then after I, you know, set the file striping to the medium, I believe, then actually it reduced like 10 minutes or maybe 20 minutes. So it's right. Huge change by just changing this striping. So yeah, so that's one thing I totally you know, neglected, or I only set that stripe small for my other lower resolution simulations. So that's one thing might be useful to others. And
So that's great. With a couple of script changes, basically a couple of lines added to the script, you got a 20 time improvement.
Exactly. And then also the nice thing is that once I set this property for the directory, then all the files underneath, you know, written after that it's inherit that property. So all the output files it's naturally striped medium size by just setting at the top directory. So that's quite handy. Yes.
Yeah, good work. Nice outcome.
And maybe another one that I might want to share is that, so this exercise was part of my preparation for running production high resolution simulation. So we are testing different number of nodes or different IO settings or compile optimizations. And one thing I was in the end of the exercise, I was calculating, okay, so at the end of 1 year, our own 1 year, how many simulation years can we get? So that's the purpose of this exercise. Yep. So that's, I just realized doing that, not just increasing number of nodes to get some improvement in the model throughput, that's not necessarily leads to many more simulation years to be done in 1 year. Because can I share one like a graph file on the chat? I made a Google spreadsheet to get the statistics for the average queue wait time for COVID-19 landing on the past 1 year. And
so were you saying you have a screen to share showing what you found?
No. I shared on the chat, but I don't know if everyone can open. Maybe.
Is it in the?
In the.
Oh, was that in the CSM channel chat?
The chat in a Zoom. Or should I put that on? Yeah.
I think that wasn't the webinar chat channel though. So. I think that was visible to a smaller group of people.
Oh, okay. Oh, I see. Oh, can see? Should I put this somewhere in the Slack channel maybe?
Do you want to copy it across to the hashtag webinars Slack channel?
Okay, can do that. So maybe do that first. Okay.
So scanning through this, it sounds like you found there's a sweet spot for the number of nodes to use for the simulation that gets the best throughput.
That's one reason. But also, I found about 20 to 30% of increase or decrease in the simulation time going from like 100 nodes to 200 nodes. But that improvement actually was overwhelmed by the wait time difference. Because wait time difference is more than 50%. So once I take into consideration all those things to get how many years of simulation we can get in a given year, actually 100 nodes is better than using 200 nodes. I have to go up to actually 1,024 nodes or more to actually to get a better annual simulation throughput.
So that's interesting in the context of our topic of the day today, which is around Slurm and how to use Slurm to minimize queue wait time and find optimal points, and that's a good consideration that looking for the sweet spot, including the queue wait time for the size and shape of your job is a worthwhile exercise.
Yeah, I was also curious about this table itself because I got this from my NERSC's tool, but it might be very large variability month to month. So there's large variability even inside those, each node count group. And then also dependency of the how many hours we request. So those kind of tips I'm kind of looking forward to hear today.
Yeah, so we'll definitely talk more about that in a short time.
Okay, thank you.
Any other wins or stories to share?
So can I actually ask a quick question to Koichi? Because I had sort of is relevant also for what we are doing. And I was curious in your table is this wait time, let me try to understand, is the number of nodes, is the wait time the average wait time per node or sort of per job they request and nodes?
This is a wait time. So if you use a request, nodes between 64 and 127, and it depends on the month, but you, on average, for example, if it's in 2020 January, okay, you have to wait almost 50 hours on average to get your job started.
But to get all those nodes.
All those nodes, meaning, to get the nodes you requested so that your job gets started. So between you submit and then until your job gets started. That's my understanding.
Okay. So it's very interesting. So requesting more nodes not necessarily makes you wait longer.
No, that's not the case, I think, on Korean night landing. And especially you get bonus for very large jobs, right? 50% discount on 1,024. And then it's wait time is usually shorter.
Okay, thank you.
So that's some very interesting tips, and we're very much getting that's very much in line with our topic of the day. So what I might do is I pause this conversation until we get up to that section, and I think we'll have an opportunity to go into some more depth and detail, and Shahzeb's got some background information about why this is the case as well.
Okay, great.
So time is actually getting along, so we might move on to our next section, which we've sort of started covering already here, which is kind of the flip side of win of the month, which is today I learned. And the thinking behind this is that, research happens by experimenting and, getting things wrong a few times until we get them right. I think we can learn from not only our own points that we got stuck and tripped up, but the things that were challenging for other people. But this doesn't have to be things that didn't work. It's also an opportunity to call out, resources you've stumbled across, for instance, or discovered recently that might be valuable to other NERSC users. So Coach's tip just before about the difference that setting striping made to his code is a good example here. People are a little bit shy to speak up. Well, we've had a few discussions, I think, of things that we learned, so we can step on to the next item. So our next segment is about announcements and calls for participation. We have a couple of announcements from NERSC side, but this is also, this is a general user forum. We're also keen to hear about, conferences, events, and so on that you know of, or perhaps organizing or you're contributing to, that would be valuable to other NERSC users. From NERSC side, you hopefully saw this already in your weekly email, etc. But the NERSC early career nominations for HPC Achievement Awards are due at the end of this week, that is to say by tomorrow. So we have two categories for these awards. One is for high impact scientific achievement, which recognizes work that has or is expected to have an exceptional impact on scientific understanding, engineering design for scientific facilities, or a broader societal problem. Society has a fairly big invisible target in the pandemic at the moment for that. The other award is for innovative uses of high performance computing, which recognizes researchers who have used NERSC's resources in innovative ways to solve a significant problem or have come up with a new methodology that might have a large scientific impact. So this can include things like, you know, using HPC in a field where it hasn't previously been used or used terribly much, or combining computing data networking and edge services to do something new in a, you know, in a domain where HPC is already in use. So for the early career eligibility, this is targeted particularly at users using NERSC resources who are early in their career. So postdocs or NERSC users who have received their degree, you know, in the last 5 years, I guess, a little over 5 years, during or after 2015. So you can nominate these people by, I think if you check in the weekly email, there is probably a link, or you can send us a ticket with the topic being, you know, nomination for award, and give us a pointer to who you know of that you would be a good recipient for one of these awards. So I think that's the only announcement we have at the moment on NERSC's side. Apart from there are a few other announcements actually of things going on in the that are in the weekly email. Does our user community here have any announcements or events that it would be good to know about? Don't forget that you can also, make announcements, tell other users about things in the NERSC Slack organization. So if we don't have anything else in the way of announcements, we can go on to our topic of the day. And I'd like to introduce Shahzeb Siddiqui, who's part of our user engagement group here and has a lot of experience with Slurm. And he's going to walk us through some of the details of, what Slurm is doing underneath, and how it works at NERSC, and how you can use that information to get more out of Slurm and spend less time in the queue. Shahzeb, if you'd like to just say next, I can click the slide through to the next one when you're ready.
Thanks. You can start. Okay. So this is going to be a quick recap on, for you guys to get up to speed on Slurm and get some best practices using our cluster. So, as you may log, use our cluster, you typically log in to our nodes. Please note that these login nodes, they're shared with many users, right? So these are not meant for a computational resource. So what you typically would do is write a job script and submit it through either SBatch, which was submitted batch job, or if you want to have interactive access to a node, then you can use SILOC, right? What you would typically do is, specify your SBatch directives and a queue, and, request a number of nodes, and, run your script. What happens in the backend is your script actually, is processed by the Slurm server. It processes the script and then finds the allocated nodes and, fulfills your request. So on Cori, we have like several login nodes. Those are, those icons in blue. And sometimes some of our login nodes are also used as compute resources, right? When a job gets allocated, you may get allocated to one node, which would be this yellow icon. If you have multiple nodes, then Slurm will do that for you. That could be those red icons. And typically at the end of the job, you will get an output or error file that's saved on the disk, right? Just one thing to also note is, we have queues that allow us to submit exclusive node. So you can do that. But we have, like, for instance, a shared queue, which is shared with multiple users. Next slide. Okay. So when you submit a job either through SBatch or basically SBatch, what happens is the job will go through several job states. So first is it will append, and Slurm will try to figure out, you know, when it needs to get the resources. So it will be in this state. It will, once it's done from pending, it will configure the nodes that are required to run the job. And then your job will actually be in a running state. You would see this as an icon, either capital R. This will be for the remainder of the job execution, and then the job will complete. And that will be the last step. And finally, if the job either completes successfully, it will be completed, or most of the other time you would see it failed, if it's a fail. If you run out of, for instance, like timeout or something like that, it would also show up as failed. But if you cancel a job, you know, that will show up. Now, as during the process of this job lifetime, you can actually monitor this job through either SQ or S control. We also have a wrapper SQS, which is to SQ. One thing to note is you use SQ and S control for the lifetime of the job from pending to completed, but you can use SACCT to query historical jobs, right? To know that, you know, using these commands frequently will ping our Slurm server. So doing too much request, you know, on like a loop can actually impact the server. So it's generally prohibited, right? Another thing to note is that we have a limit on how much you can query from SACCT. So you can just do like a really large query. I think we have it set to 31 days. Next slide. Okay, so I want to just talk briefly about how scheduling works. Currently in Slurm, here we have set up backfilling. The idea is that backfilling allows us to increase throughput of our jobs. And, you know, backfilling, what the intent is to allow jobs that are like lower priority, like short running jobs, to be filled in wherever there is gaps into the cluster. Typically short running jobs are like, you know, smaller, like really small rec boxes, like either low runtime or low number of nodes. If you see, like in this diagram, you should look at it from the top down. So jobs that are submitted a long time ago, long rectangulars are like, you know, small jobs with long running time, or like, you know, horizontal rectangulars are like you're accessing the full node, like, you know, a thousand nodes, but like, it's a very short running job. These are generally this is bad for scheduling. So Slurm will try to accommodate this and it will put it into the scheduler. But what backfilling does, it allows for short and small running jobs to be run earlier in the schedule. Like for instance, the blue and the purple one, they get submitted earlier so that we improve the throughput. And you know, without backfilling, it would generally just do first in, first serve, and that's not going to be optimal. Okay. I think we can go to the next slide. Okay. Another useful tip is to use time min. What this allows you to do is, you know, if you have a job, you don't need to guess the wall clock time. You can say something like the minimum amount of time that you need. Like for instance, if you have a job that runs, let's say 6 hours, but you want to make it less time so that Slurm will pick it up more quickly, you can say, let's say a time limit of like, let's say 3 hours. In this example, you may have a job that You don't know how much time it takes, but you expect that 3 hours is sufficient. With min time, Slurm will actually look at it and say, okay, I have a three hour time limit, and I will actually fit that in. In this diagram, if you see the whole box is actually blue, that's 6 hours, but the dark blue could be the 3 hours, and then it will just try to fit it in to the scheduler. One thing to note is that some of our queue policies require a min time. For instance, flex queue is one of them. So it's just one thing to be note of. I guess we can go to the next slide.
I'm sorry, could you go over the min time again? I'm not sure I understood. Does this, if you suspect that the job might run longer, but you don't know, and you specify min time and you run out of that time slot, what happens?
So if I can interject slightly, this is more if you know that your job has flexibility. If for instance, it has a restart capability, you know, if it's running a time step every half hour, and you can pick it up and continue from the last time step.
Okay, that makes sense. Then, thank you.
Then, you know, you could tell it to run as many time steps as you can.
But will your job get killed at the end of the minimum time? Or if it happens to take longer, it just runs till completion?
Shahzeb, would you like to answer this, or shall I?
Yeah, I'm just looking exactly. So according to what does, it's set the minimum limit on the job allocation. So the time is, it allows job to be executed earlier. It doesn't change the actual job time itself. So it improves the backfilling scheduling algorithm. So like allows scheduler to see that, you know, this job, which is supposed to be, let's say, 6 hours, it doesn't need all that time, just needs, let's say, the amount up to min time, which may be like 2 or 3 hours, and it will schedule the job ahead or earlier in the scheduling.
That's not how I understand it. Min time means that it'll run for a minimum of that many hours, but then can be killed any time between that and the maximum time.
So the time gets adjusted at the time that the job starts. So if there's a gap in the schedule of, say, 3.5 hours, and you have a min time of 2 hours in a 6 hour job, it will adjust the time of your job to 3.5 hours to exactly fill that gap.
Since it can't know the gap perfectly, does it kill your job when it's ready to fill in the job who's, you know, ready to go, or does it kill you automatically at the time it decided?
It adjusts the time at the time that the job starts. So it has a schedule, for instance, that it knows that this wide job is expected to, you know, have nodes available to it to start, say, in 3.5 hours from now. So what it does then, it adjusts your job's time to 3.5 hours. And then at the end of 3.5 hours, your job will be killed. So I think what you're asking is, you know, things can change, and maybe another job finished early, and this job that was scheduled for in 3.5 hours time might have otherwise been able to start in three. But at that point, your job's already running and it's got 3.5 hours. So it does kind of lock the schedule in.
Yeah. Okay, thanks.
Okay.
Sorry, I kind of interrupted there. Would you like to continue, Shahzeb?
That's okay. Yeah. I can go to the next one.
Next slide.
Okay. So, in terms of what we have, the queues that we have, typically you will use a regular queue for most of your workload, right? And, you know, so in terms of the cost, you know, regular queue should be sufficient. I think 48 hours is the time limit. So it should be sufficient for most of your workload. If you need, for instance, some emergency workload, premium queue is the way to go. It will submit, it will schedule a job much faster. But you know, it is more expensive, right? Premium queue is also special. So queue in the sense that not all users automatically have access to it. Your PI will have to grant you access to this. And also the charge factor gets changed once you reach, I believe, 20% is the rate. So just be mindful of that. Only use this queue when you really need to. Debug is a really good queue if you want to just submit a job just for debugging purpose. So I think it's got a 30-minute time. So it's very good. You get a good turnaround time. If you need interactive access to a node, then use the interactive queue. So one thing to know is you need to use SLOC. SBatch is not going to work. And a low QoS, this is good if you have workload that really is not that important. You don't mind having a long kind of wait time. So you can use that, and it's also very cheap. The flex queue is good if you support like flexible wall time. This queue requires you to have the min time or time min option set to at least 2 hours. It won't accept the job if you don't set this. So it has to be less than 2 hours, and it's only available on KNL. This is good for if you have your job supports like restart. So if you want it to be able to restart, if the job, for instance, gets killed. If you're going to use a shared queue, this is shared with other users. So when you submit a job, you get into a node, keep in mind that you will be sharing this node with other users. So this is good if you just want to get your jobs done, but you don't care about, in the case of like performance, you don't need exclusive node. If you do need an exclusive node, then you should use something else or just use the exclusive option. The overrun queue, this is good if you have a zero project account balance and you still need to submit jobs. Otherwise you can't use this queue. And the real queue is only for a special purpose. If you need real, like immediate access. So, yep. And you can take a look at the link below for the QoS. Next slide. Okay. So as I mentioned, you know, most of your workload should be going through the regular queue. You know, we also have the premium queue that's for, you know, like, you know, immediate kind of needs, like if you have some kind of conference that you need to submit something and only have like a week or so, you know, you could use the premium queue. So for instance, one thing to note is the flex queue, you know, it is, we do discount, I think 75% on, and it's only on KNL, right? And, you know, because it's on node, you can actually do a pretty large chunk of the node itself. So that's pretty good. And yeah, large, like if you're submitting like large jobs on KNL nodes, then we also do discount like up to 10, 20 folds with a 50% discount. So that's good to know. If you want to submit like a larger workload, and this is available on the regular queue. Okay. And yep. So just to summarize, you know, I think one thing that you may learn is, you know, is the scheduling system that we use backfilling. So if you have short running jobs, you know, just try to use, let's say, mint or time mission to get your jobs to quickly. You know, we support several queues, so pick the right queue, right? That's important. You know, use a flex queue when you need, it will save you money for sure. Use can, if you're going to submit large number of jobs up to 1024, you know, you get a 50% discount, right? And you can take a look at the link for best practices. I think that's all we have.
Thanks, Shahzeb. So we've got about 5 minutes or so for Q&A. And I see actually, Kanupriya, I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing that correctly, has asked a question in the chat. If you ask for four nodes using the interactive queue, can you do this split between two different jobs? I think you might want to clarify that question. Do you mean running different S runs together, or do you mean request two jobs of two nodes each?
Two different test runs in parallel.
Yes, you can do that. We have in the examples page of our docs, which is I might put a link to it in the chat in a moment. You can do this interactively as well. Start an S run in the background for one of the jobs, and then start the other one. What you'll probably want to do is actually, I assume that you're looking at, for instance, comparative debugging.
That's correct, yep.
As the use case. So what you probably want to do in this case is actually SSH into the node that you have a job on, and we do have some tips on that in the documentation. We'll post a link to that in the webinars channel shortly. So that then you've got two terminal windows. Only the first terminal window will have the Slurm environment. So you'll need to, you know, do the S runs from there, but you'll be able to go into the other nodes and, you know, look at them, catch them in a debugger, for instance, from another terminal window.
Okay, thanks. Can you post the documentation link, please? On the chat.
I will do that momentarily as we chat. Are there any other questions that people would like to ask?
So this is kind of related to what the earlier speaker was talking about. You know, if you have something that you expect can, you know, backfill reasonably well, so the you know, total number of core hours for your job is modest, right? But you know, essentially, you know, if you can divide the job up in a way such that, you know, you essentially have a rectangle in, you know, time node space, right? What's the best shape of the rectangle for backfilling? Is it to have, you know, short time many nodes or long time few nodes? Again, I'm assuming that it's, you know, the node time product is a modest number, you know, in the, so tens or hundreds of core hours or something.
Yeah, as a general rule, short time is much easier to find gaps for. Even quite wide gaps are relatively easy to find compared to long gaps. So a 48-hour job is almost never going to be backfilled. It's always going to wait until it reaches the front of the queue. Whereas a one-hour job, even with 1,000 nodes, will probably backfill and start ahead of its, you know, nominal place.
Good, thanks.
So just digging up, So I'm just posting now in the webinars channel. One of our docs page is example job scripts. And this is a great resource actually, well, we hope it's a great resource for examples of lots of different use cases, which includes multiple simultaneous jobs. for, I'll need to dig a little further to find the link specifically for SSHing into a node. I can see there's a few other questions in the chat as well. Right, so from Bill, Slurm job array submission is a handy way to get a lot of embarrassingly parallel tasks through the queues in smaller pieces. I'm curious how these submissions age for priority. Do they age based on the initial submission, or does each task age independently? That comes into play when, if the setting is used to control the number of tasks allowed to run concurrently. So there are a couple of ways of doing this. You can use job arrays, which use a single job script to manage a whole series of jobs with a single sbatch, or you can sbatch a whole lot of individual jobs. I presume, Bill, that you're talking about job arrays?
Yes. I recently discovered this trick, and it comes in handy sometimes, but I'm not sure how it ages in the queue and for optimal use.
So the job array, the request kind of acts as a single job, and then basically the individual jobs get kind of pulled off the request. So my understanding, and maybe Shahzeb has more information about this, is that the request will age. So the entire request will reach, the same priority. And then, when Slurm's scanning it, it will pull off, however many jobs it can start at the moment, or at least the next job that it can start at the moment from that request.
So one thing that we didn't discuss today was the how Slurm does job priority. So currently we use a Slurm feature. It's called multi-factor priority. When Slurm actually figures out which job actually needs to be scheduled, it does it based on priority. And there are multiple factors what goes into job priority, and one of the factor is age. The age of the job length, right? As it sits in the queue, and then also when it's actually running. As you may know, if it's a job that's waiting in the queue for a longer time, then the age factor will grow. That means that Slurm is trying to figure out that this job is in the queue for a long time, it needs to get scheduled, right? Same thing if the job is running for a longer time, then that's not good too. You can take a look at the link. I think one of the commands that you could use to actually get job priority is sprio, but we haven't documented that, but there is some useful things that you can get out of it. If you think that would be useful, I think we can try to put some more documentation into that. One thing to note is that SPIO works only for pending jobs. So if you have a job that's pending and you want to know the priority of pending jobs, then that could help. You can try to see priority of your job and then also sort it by the queues and stuff. It won't help you to tell when the job will start, but it will at least give you a numerical value of the priority of the job. If you don't care about priority, you can also do notification. You can have email notification when the job will start if you don't want that, but SPIO could help.
So yeah,
I don't know SPIO if it gives, helps. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I was gonna say, yeah. So SPIO gives you the breakdown of what are the components of your job's priority. I think the total number can actually be found in SQ as well.
Yes.
So we have a couple more questions have come up. I think I might address them in reverse order because of basically how easily answered they are. So Ronnie asks, do specific projects have different priority? And the answer is, for the most part, no. Different projects have different allocations, which, you know, I guess influences how many jobs they can run over the entire year. But priority is all the same. There is kind of an exception in that projects can request access to the real-time queue, and that's generally for sort of special cases such as needing to synchronize with time on an instrument somewhere, for instance, super facility type work. And real-time queue jobs have super high priority, but that's kind of a special case. In the normal course of things, one project and another project have the same priority in the queue. I see Shahzeb's posted an example of what the SPRIO output looks like. When, am I pronouncing it correctly, asks, can we explain a bit about the denial of service problem? I guess you mean about too many S runs or too many SQS requests?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So this is because Cori is quite a large system with quite a lot of users. But the scheduling, I guess, is a centralized service. And so the Slurm daemon basically has to answer requests as well as do the scheduling. And if it gets too many requests, it's multi-threaded, it scales reasonably well, but it's not omnipotent, and it is entirely possible to overwhelm it with requests. And one easy way to do that is by calling SQS or SRun in a loop, particularly with no sort of a sleep between them. The daemon will just sort of get so many requests coming from so many different directions that it starts to drown under them a little bit. So that's why we ask users not to do that.
Has such an attack happened in the past?
Certainly. Never, I think, deliberately. It's mostly mostly when this happens, it's by users who have a genuine use case. I need to start 1,000 things in my high throughput workflow, and they do the kind of obvious sounding answer, or make a loop that runs SRun, which unfortunately has this side effect of hitting the scheduler very, very hard. So as far as I'm aware, I don't know of any malicious attacks like this, but it has definitely accidentally happened. And oftentimes, if you see slow response from Slurm, if you type SQS and it seems to take ages to come back, it's probably because Slurm is dealing with a lot of requests. There was another question further up. Oh, for jobs that finish within 2 hours on KNL, is it better to use the flex queue? So that's an interesting question. If the job finishes within 2 hours, chances are it'll run fine in the normal queue. You'll get started sort of straight away. The flex queue is really for, and flex queue is valid to use for short jobs as well, but it's most useful for if you have a job that, ideally you'd like to run for quite a long time, but it can be broken up into smaller chunks. You could also, for instance, if you've got a job that, we'll run up to 2 hours, but can run in 1 hour chunks, you could use the flex queue for that as well. We're actually getting close to the top of the hour, and I think we've covered the questions that have come in the chat. We might be able to continue with a Q&A session sort of at the end of the meeting for those who are still around and available. But what we might do now is flip through the last couple of items in our agenda so that we can finish the sort of formal part of the meeting before 12 o'clock. So the next one's a fairly quick and easy one. What's coming up next? We are always looking for topic requests, suggestions, or better still, nominations and volunteers to host a topic of the day. This is a great opportunity if you want to do a kind of a relatively short, lightning talk kind of level overview of some interesting work that you're doing using NERSC resources and some tips that you've learned that might help other users. We'd love to hear about it. I think that'd make a great topic of the day. If you've got requests or nominations or self-nominations for this, please either send us a ticket or write something in the webinars channel, and we'll definitely chat with you about it. Last month's numbers. So our availability was pretty high in January. We had, you can see this black era was the scheduled maintenance that happened during the allocation year transition. We did have a very short unscheduled outage later in the month. Other than that, Corey's scheduled availability was pretty close to 100%, and the storage systems scheduled availability was at 100%. So that was good news. Corey's utilization was nicely high. Things like the flex queue are actually really helping us here because an increasing number of users are making their jobs more easily fit into gaps. We're not getting very much time of empty nodes sitting idle because they're waiting for other nodes to become available for some job. We're able to make good use of them. So that's great to see. We have a target of 25% of the workload on Corey being jobs that need a system of Corey scale, basically large jobs, things needing more than 1,000 nodes. It's good to see that Corey's being well used for this use case. So we have a 25% target, and over 40% of our workload in January was these large jobs. Tickets are coming in at a slightly faster rate last month than what we closed them. So we have a current backlog as of a couple of weeks ago of about 620 tickets. And that is all of the formal part of the meeting. If people are interested in sticking around a little longer to chat about tips on using Slurm, I think I'm available for a little longer. I'm not sure what Shahzeb's calendar looks like. Are you available to stick around for another 5 or 10 minutes if people are still asking questions, Shahzeb?
Yeah, I could stick for a few minutes. I do have a meeting. I can stick around.
Okay, so it might be only a few minutes then, and then yeah. Shahzeb will probably need to drop. But I believe we have a few other NERSC people on the line as well. So between us, we can probably answer some questions. And I wouldn't be surprised if some of our users online are also quite experienced Slurm users and can participate in that, contribute answers. Other than that, thank you all for joining us. We'll post the recording on the webpage reasonably soon after the meeting, and we'll look forward to seeing you all again next month.
Thank you.
So as people are exiting, were there any other questions that people had about making the best use of Slurm?
Can I ask a follow-up questions about this flex queue?
Sure.
For the shorter jobs, I was just curious if people, run shorter jobs like 2 hours, use flex queue in not intentional way just to get the cheaper, charge factor.
Yeah.
So that's an interesting question and a cunning plan. It's not what the flex queue is intended for.
Right. Yeah. But I thought maybe people take advantage of that. I realized today.
Don't think we actually have a mechanism in place to prevent or disallow it at the moment, but okay. It is in highly likely that that would happen if we do start to see it being used, you know, as a way of getting a discount.
Because I just learned today that has 75% discount. That's quite large. So, yeah.
Yes, it's a very good discount because it's so I guess perhaps we can talk a little bit about the intent here and you know, what are the needs and goals that we're balancing off. So one important thing to keep in mind is that for the most part, NERSC actually doesn't allocate the hours. So the Department of Energy program managers allocate the hours for projects. And so the hours allocation should then, at least in theory, reflect the priority that the DOE has for, you know, as well as I guess the needs and the, for different research. And so we don't want to kind of undermine that, you know, if the program managers really want, you know, a lot of the time to be spent in a particular area of research or a lot of resources to be dedicated to a particular area of research, we don't want to risk undermining that through, you know, discounts and so on like that. On the other hand, we don't want the system to go to waste. So, you know, we would much rather have jobs that can fill those gaps and do useful research, rather than letting those jobs sit idle. And so this is what drives having some of these discounts for things like the flex queue, is that by encouraging people to, you know, to work towards making their jobs flexible and to create jobs that work well with the scheduler to sort of, you know, optimize the experience for everybody, there's benefits all around. And so that is a, you know, a motivation behind putting a large discount there.
Yes, makes sense.
So yeah, at the moment, as far as I know, I don't think we've had, I guess, the need to police very hard whether, you know, whether users are kind of, you know, gaming the system a little bit. And I guess it will depend a lot on how much we see of that.
Yeah, and I think I saw nice point made as well in the chat that the priority is quite low for the flex queue. Once people realize that, probably we don't use that for that kind of ill-purposed way.
So if your purpose is that you have the flex queue will, you know, it's filling gaps, but it is a lower priority than others. There's also a low priority queue, which is actually starts slightly higher than the flex queue, but has a 50% discount. Mm. So if you have a project that is, not rich in terms of NERSC hours, but the workload doesn't have high urgency, then, you know, you can use the low queue to stretch your NERSC hours further.
Suddenly, yes, okay, yeah, thank you. Well, that's curious.
I see another couple of questions here about cluster expansion calculations, how to keep it running at over 48 hours. So that's a good question. So Xing, am I pronouncing that correctly? Asked about what if you just do have a workload that takes more than 48 hours unavoidably. So this is kind of a challenge, and the best and preferred solution is if that workload can be made to support stopping and starting, so that it can be broken up into smaller chunks. You can actually use, we have a documentation page about variable time jobs, where we've got some example scripts pretty much for setting up a long workload to use the flex queue to break it up into chunks and then resubmit itself at, you know, when it reaches the end of one time chunk to, you know, sort of automatically do long running jobs, but that does require the job to be capable of checkpointing. The reason for having a 48-hour limit is that, well, apart from that, longer jobs are harder to schedule and will tend to spend a huge amount of time sort of stuck in the queue. Longer running jobs make it more difficult for scheduling things like maintenance, or if you know, if the system becomes unavailable, there's a higher, I guess, probability of interrupt that way.
So, I was just going to say, yep. I'm not sure if we allow, I guess, our administrators to bump the time limit. I mean, we can extend it, but generally we don't, right?
So it is possible using a reservation to get a longer time limit, but this is kind of exceptional circumstances. Yeah, you don't want this to be your normal workflow. So yeah. Another thing that's worth looking at is we're working with the developers of a checkpoint restart package called DMTCP, which for jobs that don't have their own built-in checkpoint and restart capability, in a lot of cases, even for MPI jobs, this can allow the job to be stopped, you know, within 48 hours, even running the flex queue for a few hours at a time and automatically re-queued. I'll post a link in the chat and in the webinar channel. Oops, wrong link, sorry.
I think reservation would be the best if it was a night.
About using checkpoint restart. See, if you do have a long running job, take a look at that. If all else fails, you can request a reservation. What we'll probably actually do is try to work with you first to see if we can find a more sustainable way to, perform that workflow. So I think we've covered all the questions that have turned up in the chat. If there's any that I've overlooked, please speak up.
I was just curious, one more question about the table I made out of this web page too. I wonder if you guys have any idea about the variability within each group or each column I made, like for example, between in the 64 to 128 nodes among that group, like how much variability typically is expected?
So that's a really interesting question, and it's quite an interesting table. Hang on, I wonder if I can share the screen with that. Let's stop share screen.
And also I'm curious about the reasons, possible reason behind that the month-to-month variations, at least in 2020, I didn't go further back.
So I have to admit, this is not something I've looked into, and I don't know if anybody else at NERSC, it's entirely possible somebody else at NERSC has looked a little more than it. More into it than what I have. But I suspect that what we're seeing here is really driven by the workload. There is more variability than I expected to see. So, which might just imply that there is a different workload at different times. Something that's a fairly easy, I guess, statistical trap to trip up on with the wait time charts is there is a second chart on that page showing the number of jobs. And in some cases, when you see the wait time might be particularly high or particularly low for a certain category. But then when you look, it's because during the period, there was only a very small number of jobs, 5 or 10 jobs that requested that sort of, that particular shape. And so these statistically probably not too significant jobs may be kind of adding a lot of, if you like, false variability.
I see. So yeah, indeed, it's actually more like a 2D space, right? I collapse that into 1D because I ignore the,
The number of?
Number of hours requested.
Mm.
Okay.
So this is, and this is particularly by number of nodes. That's a point as well. Yeah, then the number of hours will add sort of a second dimension to it.
Yeah, but I didn't. I don't see other tables in this particular web page too that the the numbers as a function of hours requested. Only graphically, it is represented, I believe.
As in getting the underlying table behind this chart.
Yeah,
that information should be available, but I don't think we specifically, publish it. So it's not that it's hidden. It's just not actively published.
Right. Okay.
So I think this is the chart that you were using.
Hold on. Yes. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. And I was just using, only focusing on KNL and then pretty much copy and paste from the first table.
Here we go. I hadn't actually noticed this either, but if you scroll down a little bit further, there is the numbers.
Jobs, yeah.
Jobs, average wait time. Although this is just by nodes and not necessarily by time weighted. Wall time requested. So you will sometimes find that here, some of these, in this square, there was only 6 jobs. And so that, is contributing to, one of these boxes here, because it's not very many jobs, it's not statistically fantastic.
Right.
So it is something to have in mind when you're looking at this. Another really useful one I find that in a way zooms out a little bit and I think can be a bit helpful because of that is this backlog. And what this is showing is the total amount of queued work in terms of all of Cori days. So if you just submitted a job, it's presumably somewhere near the back of this queue. And it's going to take it, in this case, if it's a Haswell job, around about 10 days to get to the front of the queue.
Okay.
Now, hopefully, if it's a little bit short, it'll be able to backfill and fill and start a lot sooner than that.
Okay.
You will notice that KNL jobs have a much lower backlog. They're in the kind of the 2-day range compared to 10 days for Haswell. And that is driven partly by the fact that we have 5 times as many KNL nodes.
Right. And in this context, the backlog means just wait time, kind of? Or
perhaps a way to describe it is with an example. If you imagine Cori had 100 nodes in total, and you've got jobs submitted, so you've got a job that requests 50 nodes for 2 hours, and another one that requests 25 nodes for 2 hours, and another one that requests 50 nodes for 4 hours, then you've got a total amount of work here of about 100 nodes for about 6 hours. Mm-hmm. That calculation is not correct, but something like that. So that would be a backlog of 6 hours of work queued for the entire 100 nodes.
Okay, I see. Got it.
So the numbers for Cori are obviously a lot bigger because there's somewhere in excess of 12,000 nodes. There's about 10,000 KNL nodes. So there's 2.2 days times 10,000 nodes worth of work currently queued for Cori KNL.
I see. Oh, thank you. I never really looked at that. And I didn't quite understand the title backlog history before. So This is very nice.
I find it can be a helpful summary of just how busy the machine is.
How busy the machine is.
Okay. Yeah, how much work it has sort of lined up to do.
Okay.
On the queue wait time, you're saying a lot of these jobs can be scheduled and completed much faster, correct?
As in the job sizes?
Right, well, at any given time, and for instance, you submit a job, a lot of times I've seen this, you submit a job and then they do SQS and tells me there's a backlog of 3 days, but then my job gets scheduled in an hour.
Yeah. Yeah, and that happens because...
That always confused me, and is that related to what we're seeing here?
So that's actually related to... hang on, let's just go back and...
I could explain this.
Yeah, go ahead.
So SQS, we removed that column now. Before what we had is that it tells you it's going to be starting 3 days. Actually, it's not going to start in 3 days. It's about its priority is going to be reaching the threshold that scheduler will consider it. So this is for the backfill pass. But then there's also, when you see it happens immediately, it's because it's backfilled. So the column tells you it's going to reach the threshold for the scheduler to consider its regular pass in how many days, because we have a threshold set there. But then all the jobs in there, if it's short enough, small enough, you can get an opportunity to get backfilled, it will run quickly.
What is this threshold again that you're...
This is what this plot sort of tells you. We have in our configuration actual numbers. So if you submit a job in a regular queue, you come in with a start priority. And then we have it takes you 3 days to start to be scheduled. But actually recently removed that wait time. The original we had this is manual wait time for a regular job to be scheduled. Our new scheme does not need to have this manual wait to, originally we had some related bugs that without this wait, there were issues related to the system overall utilization. And newer version does not need this wait anymore. So basically a job submit, it already reached the threshold. So that's why we removed that column. You're not seeing it in SQS anymore.
Okay.
Or something like that.
Okay, so we shouldn't worry about that.
Yeah.
That's not the backlog that we're talking about here.
No, it was our old threshold difference, not anymore.
Yes, but the backlog, now returning to that diagram, the backlog just means that this is how much work is kind of scheduled and waiting to be done, but it doesn't mean that that's exactly how long it will take for these jobs to finish. Many of them could finish early, many of them could error out, and etc. Right?
The backlog is like however many workload is in the system right now. New jobs have been after that, like right now, you could still finish maybe before that because there are some jobs submitted in the priority lower than yours. And there are also some users have more than two jobs in the queue and they're big enough, they're not fitting to backfill. So those jobs are basically scheduled two at a time and your job just submit will be considered for scheduling before those jobs.
So expanding on that a little bit. So your job goes into the queue at some point. With a your priority basically increases over time. The change that Helen was talking about where you used to see like a 3 day wait was because queue regular used to start out down here and it would take 3 days to get up to this line. Whereas now it starts right at the top. But only two jobs can increase past this line at a time per user. And above here, this is the part of the queue that Slurm spends a lot of time trying to find a place to schedule the job to start. And then for everything below that, it does a quick run through and just asks, can I start this job right now? So the reason, so the two jobs that Helen was talking about is that this limitation that only allows two jobs per user to cross this line at a time. And the reason that you see a job start very quickly is usually because the scheduler scanned down there and found, oh, I can fit this job in an existing gap. Between all of that, did it sort of make a somewhat clear picture?
Yep, thank you.
So we're almost at 12:30 now, and it might be time to close out the meeting. Thanks all for sticking around for further discussion. And thanks, Shahzeb, again, although I think he's dropped out, for telling us about Slurm. And we'll look forward to seeing you all again next month.